Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel Optimizer. So we are right now in the series of 1D mesh in hyper mesh. Okay, so in this video we are going to start with how to use a rod element. So in last video we have discussed what are the different types of elements are there. 1D elements are there, in that we have discussed rod, bar, beam and other some elements. So in this video we are going to use rod element, and with the help of rod element we are going to solve one beam problem. Okay, so before starting with hyper mesh we need to know which process we need to follow. Okay, so for solving a 1D problem with hyper mesh you need to use these 6 steps. Okay, so it is a shortcut of that steps are MHPCLL. Okay, where M stands for material, H stands for hyper beam, P stands for property, C stands for component, load collector and load step. Once again I will tell: material, hyper beam, property, component, load collector and load step. Okay, so this material is related to material properties of the component which you are going to analyze. Hyper beam means where you are going to define the cross section area of the beam. P is the property of the element, it is not a material property. You are going to define the type of element which you are going to use. So here we are going to define the property of the element. Component, where we are going to draw an actual beam. L, that is load collector, where you are going to define a different kind of boundary conditions, that is load collector. And last step is load step, where you are going to combine all the load collector, load boundary condition which are defined in the load collector. Okay, so these 6 steps we need to follow in the hyper mesh. Okay, so in this video we are going to solve this problem, this beam problem. So this is the cantilever beam in which uniaxial compression force is applied on this beam. So the cross section area of the beam is circular, which has a diameter around 25 mm. So Young's modulus is around 2.1 into e raised to 4, and Poisson's ratio is 0.3, and the length of the beam is 500 mm. Okay, so as we know, rod element is suitable only for uniaxial tension compression problem. As this is uniaxial compression problem, we are going to use rod element in this case. Okay, so the some analytical calculation has been carried out, so we will validate this hyper mesh result with this analytical result later. So let us start with hyper mesh. So we are going to start from solve this problem with these steps, and this is the problem. Okay, so let us start. So coming back to hyper mesh, so this is the GUI of hyper mesh as we have discussed in earlier video. If you are new to video, please go back and see all the hyper mesh series. So from where we need to define the material. So for that you need to use this material. So that for that you need to open this collector toolbar, which is located exactly below this graphics area. Okay, so just click on this material. Now just you need to click on this create. Okay, so material name, any name you can give. For example, I am going to give steel. Okay, now you need to define which type of element is this, which type of element is this. Now normally we know isotropic means properties are same in all direction, anisotropic means properties are different in different direction, orthotropic is related to the composite material, hyperelastic, the rubber like element you need to define under hyperelastic, fluid and gasket. So these are different sections of the materials available in the hyper mesh. From that we are going to use isotropic element. Okay, and one more thing you need to define here, that is card image. So there are two kind of card image available under isotropic, that is MAT1 and MAT4. MAT1 is basically for structural component or structural problem, and MAT4 is basically for thermal problem. Now our problem is structural one, so you need to select this MAT1. Okay, so once you have selected isotropic MAT1, then you need to click on this create edit. Don't click on this create, you need to click on this create edit, and here you need to define the properties of the material. Just see, E stands for Young's modulus, G is for bulk modulus, this is for Poisson's ratio and density. So there are many things here you can define. So the meaning of each, you can go to help menu of the hyperworks and you can check that one. So right now we required only Young's modulus and Poisson's ratio. So if you just see our problem, so Young's modulus is 2.1 e raised to 4 and Poisson's ratio is 0.3. okay, so 2.1 e4 and Poisson's ratio is 0.3, correct? Yeah. And just click on this return. Once you have defined this, now you need to click on this return. Okay, so whatever process you need you are going to doing here is going to be recorded here. So our first step is defining the material, that's already we have finished. Okay, so whatever process you are going to follow, that is going to be recorded under this model tool browser. Okay, so material already we have defined. Now next step, we know that is hyperbeam, that is H. So from where we need to define that? So for that you need to go to 1D hyperbeam, 1D hyperbeam. So in that you need to select standard section. Okay, and from here cross section area of our problem is solid circle, you need to select this solid circle. So standard section, solid circle, and now you need to click on this create. Okay, so once you have clicked on this one, hyper beam dialog box will be open. So this is hyper beam where you are going to define the cross section area of different beams. Okay, it takes 5 seconds to open it. Okay, now here you can define the we can say radius. So the total diameter of the beam is 25, so radius we need to define here 12.5, correct? So 12.5. so once you are defined, just click on enter. So 12.5 is radius is created. Just see here, R is 12.5, and relative calculation of this will be shown here. The area is around 490. What will be the moment of inertia, all things are automatically calculated. So we now, if you want to again come to hyper works or hyper mesh from this hyper beam, then you need to click on this model view. Okay, so this is our second step, that is we have defined the hyper beam, that means cross section we have defined, correct? Cross section we have defined. Yeah. So just see, M, H we have defined. Now next one is P, that is property. So just go to property. So from here, as this is uniaxial tension compression, I am going to give the property name as a rod. And from here, you need to select which type of element. So in this case, we are going to use a 1D element. So type, you need to select 1D. Card image, you need to select as P beam, P rod. As property of rod you are going to define, you need to select P rod. Okay, and material, whatever material you are defined, it will be shown here. So that you need to select. Also beam section means cross section. So circle section we have defined, so you can select this one. Okay, and then you can click on this create edit, and if you just see, the cross section is shown here at as 490. Okay, now you can click on return. So we have defined a material, hyper beam and property. So three steps we have completed, that is MHP. Now next one is component, load collector and load step. So now coming back to this one, we have a beam of 500 mm length. Already we have defined the cross section area. Now you required to define the length. Okay, so how to define length? So if you just see this, you have applied force at this section, but the cross section area from this end to this end is same. Okay, that means with the help of this formula you are going to calculate the stress, but as the force is same, also the cross section area is same, the stress value is going to be same throughout the beam, correct? So you can define this problem with only one element, or you can describe this model with only one element. So you require two nodes and one element to describe this model, as the stress value is same throughout the beam. Okay, so just coming back to hyper mesh again, just go to geometry, and from this you need to define two nodes. Okay, so first nodes will be at 000, create. You can click on this one, or you can click F menu, F key, and x distance is 500, just click on create. Okay, so 0 and 500. So we have created two nodes. Now, as we have discussed, only one element is required to describe this model. So two nodes already we have created. Now we need to create an element in between these two nodes. Okay, so for that, for creating a 1D element, you need to go to 1D page. Okay, so just click on this 1D, and now you can go to rods. So as we are going to create the rod element, you need to select rod from this one. Okay, then you need to select the property. So whatever the property you have defined, you need to select that one, and element type. So element type is C rod, that is component of rod element, you need to select. Okay, as you have selected the rod element, the property here also you need to select rod component for rod element. Okay, and then you can select first node and second node. So just see, C rod element is created now. Okay, also we have assigned property to this one, that's why. Now if you want to check whether the cross section is assigned or not, how to check it? So you need to go to this 1D detailed representation. So just click on this arrow and click on this 1D detailed element representation and click on this shaded element. Okay, and just you just press Ctrl and left click and you can rotate this, and if you just see, the cross section is assigned now to the beam, correct? So this is what we require, cross section is assigned. So if you just see, we have described the 3D structure with 1D element. Virtually we have assigned the cross section to the element. Okay, now you can delete these temporary nodes because element we have created, so automatically the nodes are created at the end of the elements. Okay, so you can just go to geometry, temporary nodes, and just click on this clear all. Nodes will be automatically deleted. Okay, now if you just see M, H, P and C, so four steps we have covered. Okay, so one more thing you need to check, that you need to assign a different color for different entities. For example, for property I have selected this, correct? For component, for material I will select yellow color. So I have defined a different color for different entities. Why to select a different color, that I will describe later. So now we will move towards the fifth step, that is load collector. So there are two kind of boundary conditions are there, that is fixing this end and applying force to this end. So there are two boundary conditions, that means two load collectors we required. Okay, so you can define the load collector from this one, load collector. So I'm going to define SPC, that is single point constraint. Here no card image is required for this one, and just click on this create. Okay, now return. So I defined the load collector, and I'm going to assign a color for that as like this. Okay, now I'm going to fix this end. So for applying any kind of boundary condition, you need to go to analysis page. Okay, so there are different pages here, so menu pages we can say, to just go to analysis page, and from that you need to select the constraint, and then you can select this node, and here all degree of freedoms you are going to restrict. Okay, so what is mean by DOF1, DOF2 to up to DOF6? So first three DOF, that is DOF 1, 2, 3, is for translation in XYZ, and DOF 4, 5, 6 is stands for rotation in XYZ. Okay, so we are going to restrict all degree of freedom at this node. So just click on this create. So just see, total all 6 degree of freedoms are restricted here. So whatever the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 is shown here, it is called as degree of freedom restricted at that location. Okay, now one more load collector we required for defining the force. So just click on, just enter force, click on create, and from here again you can define a different color. I'm going to apply a red color for that. Again go to analysis, as we are going to apply some forces, and select force from this one. Okay, now we want to apply force in this direction. So if you just see, this is x direction. Now you need to select from this x axis. Okay, and the force direction is in opposite to this axis. So how much force is there? 10 kilonewton force you need to apply. So here minus 10 kilonewton force you need to apply, correct? So again you can select this node and just click on this create. So if you want to increase the size of this force arrow, then you can click on this one and just increase the size like 50. Okay, just see force value is also shown here. Okay, so whatever the model is here, that is fixed in this case and force applied in this direction, so total model is described here. And also we have defined 5 steps and only one last step is remaining, that is load step. So again that is present in analysis page only. So load step, as we have discussed, load step is the only useful for combining a different boundary condition. Okay, so I'm going to give name as a rod, SPC, and load you can select from this. So SPC means this we are going to select, and load means force we are going to select, and type of analysis you need to select here. So I have selected linear static and then click on create. Okay, so now if you just see here, M, this is H, P also we have defined, that is component, that is C also, that is four step, load collector and load step. So all 6 steps we have defined in this model, correct? Now why to define a different boundary, different color for different entities? Okay, so now I am going to activate a 3D view, okay, detailed representation. Now just see here the bicomponent entities are showing, okay, element color mode. This is called as element color mode and it is bicomponent. Therefore whatever the component color is there, it is going to be assigned here. Now if you want to check whether the material property is assigned or not, so instead of by component you need to select here by material. Okay, so just click on this by material. So whatever color you are defined here, just see here it is yellow, it will be shown to this one. Likewise if you want to check whether the property is assigned or not, just go here and select by property. Okay, so respective color is shown here. Okay, so this is how you need to check whether all the entities are assigned to that object or not. Okay, that's why we need to define a different boundary condition. Also you can check whether SPC is included in this one or not, and also the force is included on in this collector or not. So how to verify that? Just check the color of that one. So this color red is assigned to this one, that's why we can see that this force is under this collector. Okay, so we have defined all these steps. Now you need to save this model, so just click on this save, and now you can we can save this with rod 1. Okay, and just click on save. Okay, we have saved this model, that is rod 1. Now go to analysis. So this is total what we can say a pre-processor step. Now we are moving towards second step, that is solution. So OptiStruct is by default solver provided by the HyperMesh. So that is analysis, go to OptiStruct, and from here you can select all, optimization is analysis, and just run this one. Just click on yes. So one dialog box will be open. So we have defined all these things in our problem. So just see here, whatever this is called as solution phase. Okay, so all the processes will be, the software will solve all the things whatever we have defined, and finally you are going to get some results. So here the message is coming as analysis completed. Just click on these results. Just you need to click on this result so that the HyperView will be open. Okay, so HyperMesh is pre-processor tool, OptiStruct is solution tool, and HyperView is the post-processor tool. So once you click on the results, automatically the HyperView window will be open. Okay, HyperView window will be open. So just wait for 5 seconds only. Yes. So analysis results will be shown here, and just click on this apply so that whatever we have solved will be applied to this model. And now you can check the displacement, just go to contour and click on apply. Okay, so it is around 0.48. So this blue color denotes the minimum deformation. So this is the plot of displacement. It is 0 and maximum displacement is around 4.8 e^-1, that is 0.48. So just compare with this one, 0.48, we have received that by analytical solution also. So we have matched both analytical with also with hypermesh. Okay, now also you can check the stresses. So just go to element stresses and again you can click on this apply. So if you just see, it is -2.03 e^1, that means -20 stresses are generated. And if you just cross check, correct. So by analytical also we have received 20 megapascal, and by hypermesh also we have received 21. We have obtained 20 megapascal stresses. Okay, so only the sign convention is minus because we have applied the compressive force. That's why compressive stresses are generated. That's why it is denoted by minus. Okay, so I hope you understood this. So if you like our video and if you want more knowledge about hypermesh, please subscribe our channel. So let us meet to next video. Thank you.